The story of quantum mechanics is just that. It's a story. It was fabricated by generations of scientists to explain observations that we really may have no way to actually understand. But there's cool things about the world of quantum mechanics, and one of them is that it relates very much to the electromagnetic spectrum. Quantum mechanics is all about energy levels, and energy levels are all about the electromagnetic spectrum, and the electromagnetic spectrum is something that sometimes, at least, we can actually literally see. So let's take a look at this. About the turn of the last century, about 1900, molecular and atomic behavior was starting to be understood. Max Planck had come up with the idea that maybe energy can come in packages instead of being continuous. Ernest Rutherford had conducted his famous gold foil experiment, and it was understood that the protons are in the middle and the electrons are in the outside. The protons and the electrons are attracted to each other. The world of physics at this time was dominated by the work of Sir Isaac Newton. Newton's all about force equals mass times acceleration. The formula for centrifugal force is this one. So under Newtonian physics, the electrons go around the protons and are attracted by gravitation and separated by centrifugal force. So the force is between the positive and the negative charges. The mass is the mass of the electron. The velocity would be the linear velocity of the electron, and the radius would be the distance between the electron and the proton. So the physicists look at this around the world and realize that this is not going to work. Newtonian physics is not going to work for atomic structure. Niels Bohr, in 1913, broke the ice with this. Niels Bohr says, this is not going to work, guys. We're going to have to come up with something different. We're going to have to start making stuff up. I want to start the ball rolling with this. Electrons are in stable energy levels. We know that to be true. There are other stable energy levels, and when an electron moves from one stable energy to another, a piece of energy is either absorbed or given off, and that piece of energy looks like one of Max Planck's photons. This is the simplest graph you could ever imagine. There's no x-axis whatsoever. The y-axis represents energy, but notice there's no numbers on it. Let's put an electron in this energy level. So we have an electron in the stable energy level here. Niels Bohr used hydrogen, so let's just use hydrogen. We take the hydrogen and we excite the electron in some way, like perhaps with a spark, with high temperature, something like that. And this electron will move to a higher energy level. And that change is associated with a photon. That's a discrete amount associated with a discrete amount of energy. This is right out of the work of Max Planck. So, and then if the hydrogen atom is excited even more, the electron might jump up to this higher energy level. So these are two different jumps, and there are two different photons associated with them. They're very distinct. This is a distinct photon, and this is a distinct photon, which moves the electron up to this level, and then up to this level. And that's pretty much the whole story. I want to look at one more graphic. So this is another simple graph. This graph represents the electromagnetic spectrum. So this is a part of the very, very large radio waves and infrared and ultraviolet and gamma rays and microwaves and x-rays fit on the electromagnetic spectrum. Okay, so we have an electron and we excite it into a different energy level. It absorbs a specific wavelength. It absorbs a specific proton. Okay, we excite it further and it jumps up to yet another higher level and gives us another photon at a higher energy. And then there's a statistical certainty that an electron will jump, make the first jump, and then turn around and make the second, and then make a second jump. So it's going to jump to here and jump to here. So this piece is going to give us a little tiny peak. It's not going to be very big. It's going to be like maybe about right here, and it's going to be real small. So there's a statistical certainty that an electron will jump and then jump again, but there's also a statistical unlikelihood. So the peak's not going to be very big. And that's pretty much all there is to it. The frequency is going up in this direction, which means that the bigger the jump is, the higher the frequency. And that's about all there is to it. Niels Bohr by no means ended this story. Niels Bohr just started things rolling. The mathematicians, especially Schrodinger and Niels Bohr himself, turned around and started adding complex mathematics to this. As data was collected, the model got more and more complicated, but this is essentially the nuts and bolts of it. And the cool thing is that much of it is related to spectroscopy. In fact, the whole field of quantum mechanics is related to spectroscopy. Quantum mechanics is a story that's contrived by human beings to explain things that we really can't understand. I know when I was a student, I was constantly struggling to try to relate this to things that I knew from before, and you can't do that.